So this is, let's call it the modified Mark Vandermeer style dehydrator. It's a fig pasty, isn't it? So this is a model that I've seen people use something very similar in the humid, like eastern seaboard regions, where a lot of your harvest is coming during a season that you also have frequent rain and high humidity, where you have to heat the air in order to be able to dry food. And it's also been used with good success in other climates, like here, where it's less humid, but it just gives you a nice quality of drying for a large quantity of food. So this is the solar collector, and then there's a gap here that where that air comes into the cabinet, and then the air flows down through the trays. There's a gap here, and a false wall that takes the air back up here, and then this part is cut off from the cabinet except to that false wall, so it's functioning as a solar chimney, reheating that air that picks up some moisture and setting it up. We put a very small amount of test food in to see how it would work, so let's see how it did. This latch system pushes the door shut against these seals. We've got some sort of squishy insulating seals there, so you get a really nice airtight seal. And then we have dried pears. So those basically spent one full day in there yesterday, and then they've been in there for part of this morning. Looks like we might need to work oh my goodness.
There's so much stuff on here.
That is really good. Do you want to come have some?
Sure.
That is our dried pears.
No.
They're not quite crispy. They're at that like really perfect chewy stage. I like to eat dried pears with pecans because they're like almost like caramel. I would call that a success. This is a successful food dehydrator. This is some herbs that I put in there. Not too cheap to buy fruit. but we got some mullein. That's drying up really well too. It's been in there one day and it's getting that kind of crunchy feel. So with food preservation, you want it crunchy. You don't want it chewy if you're not going to add any citric acid or salt or anything to keep the bugs out. So the pears would stay in a little longer if we wanted to stick them in a jar and not have to refrigerate them. But the herbs are doing really well too. So part of this design is it keeps the sun off the food so that you don't get any loss of micronutrients or vitamins or some of the volatiles in herbs. Can be lost if you bleach them in the sun while you're dehydrating them. You tend to keep them out of the light to get the best medicinal qualities for medicinal herbs. So yeah, I would, if I was using this, I'd want to maybe stick some little thermal probes in there and figure out if the bottom of the cabinet's cooler and the top's hotter, then you might dry your fruit up here and your herbs down here, things like that. And just practice with it till you know how fast it dries and so on. Do you want to kind of see inside the cabinet here? We actually went inside to check it out and like shut each other in, and it doesn't feel like being shut in the high school locker because you've got this little light hole up there, so it's just this kind of cool cave-like space with no direct light but kind of diffuse light coming in. So, while I'm here, these are two sample boards of the milk paints that we use. We did try a wheat paste paint first, which was a nearly dismal failure. Wheat paste is a good archival glue for gluing paper to paper, and we used it on another project that Fred had worked on because I thought it was kind of nice to honor Fred being vegan by not using animal products in the paint. But it turns out that when you put wheat paste in a high temperature application, it like bakes into little crispy cereal flakes. In this case, crispy cereal flakes full of charcoal. And so we ended up having to go back and sand the whole surface and then try a new natural paint, because we don't want to use a paint that's going to off-gas and taint the food with weird chemical smells or flavors or toxic contamination. And particularly here on Wheaton Labs, where I love paint, but I want it to be super non-toxic paint. And Paul hates paint, but he's okay with food-grade non-toxic paint. So we kind of meet at a place that we're both moving forward. So, So this is sort of a classic milk paint recipe that's made like the old dairy farms. They'd use a milk paint for whitewash and barn paint and things like that. It's made with 2 gallons of skim milk, 2 cups of white vinegar. You stir those up together, let them set for at least a couple hours. I think we did it overnight. Then you strain those curds through a fine cloth, like a muslin or a three layers of cheesecloth or something like that. Butter muslin would work perfectly because that's what it's for. You take the curd, which is like 2 to 4 cups of casein milk curd. You mix that with about a cup of lime, like Typess lime or hydraulic lime, like a moistened active lime. And the alkali in the lime interacts with the casein and it makes this cool, like translucent goo. That goo is your paint base, it's your binder. But if you just paint that goo on things really thick, it'll tend to peel off and crackle. It sticks to itself better than the surface, and it'll bind up and curl off. And so you mix that binder with at least 1-to-1 with pigment. You can go 2-to-1, 3-to-1 with like a lot more pigment than binder, and it'll still work really well. In some ways, it'll work better. So this one's the classic milk paint. This is a recipe that I wanted to try out that I've used in my house on interior finishes. That's a milk paint that's a lot easier to make. And I did a borax water on this one because I wanted to make a black with no lime in it. Either way, you're using an alkali to set the casein into a paint base. So we use 1 cup of borax water, which is just where you put like half a cup of borax and a couple of cups of water and you let it stir it up, and when there's still solids on the bottom, you know it's saturated. Like the borax, as much as you can possibly dissolve in the water, has dissolved. You can do it with warm water, get a little more. And so that water, you leave the solids, but the water is what you use that's saturated with borax. A cup of that, a cup of yogurt, a cup or two of the pigment. In this case, it was an activated charcoal powder we used as a pigment. If you don't own a dairy farm, yogurt is like plain non-fat yogurt is easily available. I think it's actually cheaper for the amount of casein you get compared to buying the milk, because it's less perishable. So you're not paying the premium for them to be storing fresh milk in the grocery store. And I was excited to do a side-by-side test, because I think of it as like the cheap and easy recipe. And I was extremely happy that it also turned out to be the better quality paint for this purpose. It didn't crack as much. It's got a darker, more matte finish. Tim measured a 4-degree temperature difference where my paint was getting hotter in the solar collector, so it's like, you know, that's very exciting when you have a success with it. And it kind of made up for the fiasco with the wheat paste. So. They were both my paint. It's just, we did eventually get to a good paint. So let's look at the collector surface.
Perfect segue.
Are we done?
Let me get inside there real fast.
I think we should eat more pears and then we should be done. Do you want to help me eat more pears? No? Okay. Do you want to take some to your mom? Does she like pears?
Yeah, but if you want to just do all the close-up stuff. Yeah. I'll just give you these 2 memory cards.
Why don't you go take your mom and dad some pears?
You can copy it all over to your computer. And then maybe just copy the close-up stuff you got over to the cards.
Take that to them.
For me?
That should be enough.
Would that work for you?
Just a second. All this is being recorded.
Sorry.